And we're back. You're listening to Talking Boston with Billy C. And don't forget, man, we want you to join us this 4th of July weekend in Reno, Nevada for the centennial of the Jack Johnson, James Jeffries fight. Took place 100 years ago this 4th of July weekend. And we want you to hang out with us, man. We're going to be there, and it's real easy. Just go to the website, www.talkingboxing.com, T-A-L-K-I-N, boxing, B-O-X-I-N-G.com, or BillyCBoxing.com, and click the big poster that says Johnson Jeffries, and you'll get all the information on that. Hey, make sure you remind me that you're showing up, because we're going to have a Billy C get-together, and I need to get a head count. I know it seems like it's a long way away, but hey, it's going to come along pretty quickly. Well, joining us right now, he's a former world heavyweight title challenger. You hear us talk about this guy all the time. Ron Lyle joins us. Good morning, Ron.
Yeah, good morning.
Hey, man.
How are you?
Great, great. Thank you very much for taking some time out and spending some time with us this morning. Before I get into you know, what you're doing today and all that happy stuff, what's your assessment? I know you. I know when we spoke last week, I know you're up on boxing. A lot of your colleagues, you know, they kind of don't follow it anymore, but I know you do. What do you think about, well, first, the heavyweight division compared to when you used to fight?
Well, I'd like to think that the heavyweight division is just as good as it was when I was there. The reason why I say that is because each class learns from the guys before them. You know what I mean?
Yep, yep.
And so that's why I say we learn from Joe Louis and Marcianos and Con Basilios, these people. Well, these people are learning. The people that came behind us learned from us. So the game, it just keeps growing and keeps growing and keeps growing and gets better. Do they throw more punches? It depends on who you're talking about. Are there harder punches? Some of them are, because they're a lot bigger. Sharper punches? In our area, there were a lot of sharp punches. Ernie Schaefer's, Ken Norton, George Foreman, me, myself, Quarry, Ali was a very sharp puncher, fast puncher, but a sharp puncher. So a sharp puncher could take you out. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah. No, you make an interesting point, and you're actually the first guy that's ever really said that, and you're right. You know, every generation benefits from the one prior to them. You know, I mean, no, Sugar Ray Robinson would have never known how to dance around it if he didn't have someone else to look at. You know, I mean, he got to watch other people, right?
That's right. Like Ali was a big Sugar Ray. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
He patterned himself after Sugar Ray. That was his mentor. That was the guy that gave him the keys to the game. So in return, not even knowing, Ali was passing those same skills on to people like myself, people like the Quarries, people like the Holmeses. They learned how to use their jab. I had a good jab, a good left hook, a good right hand. I learned how to move. I learned how to move clockwise, counterclockwise, clockwise to get away, counterclockwise to get inside. So I learned a lot from the game. I learned a lot from the people before me. And so in return, you give it to the people coming behind you. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Especially the ones that are paying attention. The guys that pay attention, the guys that pay attention and dedicate themselves to the game, those are the students of the game. The guys that come in the game and think they can make a suck out of the game, they end up hurting themselves. It's just that simple. That's the way it is.
You know, a lot of kids get involved with the sport today, and you know, I ask them all the time, what do you want to get out of the sport of boxing? And unfortunately, the first answer that comes out of their mouth 9 times out of 10 is money. You know, and it's like that's
right.
they're in the wrong profession. I mean, you guys especially in the early 70s, you know, that era now we look upon as one of the best ever in the heavyweight division. And you know, really, you guys just started towards the end of the Ali era of really making serious money. Whereas, you know, fighters today, they think that they're going to make $1 million for a 4-round fight.
Well, there again, you know, that's the times we live in. When I was fighting, I fought for the respect of my peers. You know what I'm saying? It's a little different now. The kids now fight for the money, because the money is so large. I mean, you're looking at millions and millions of dollars. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Whereas when I came along, my top purse was $200,000-$300,000 at tops. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah, no, I know.
I mean, you know, $100,000, they make that their first 6 months in boxing when they come from the Olympics.
Yeah, if they had a successful Olympic career, because then
you look
at the other guys, and you know somebody that doesn't have that that might not have had the extensive amateur career. They're fighting for $100 a round. You know they're getting right in the ring for they're $400-$500 for a four rounder.
They're still coming up the hard way. The game never changes. The people that play the part, you know, that changes. But the game itself will never change. It'll always be the same. Fours to six, six to eight, from eights to tens, from tens to twelves, from twelves, you're headed for the championship. But now, 12-round fight is tops. Back in my day, 15. You know what I mean?
Yeah. The other thing, Ron, I don't mean to cut you off, but you know what another thing that I hear all the time, and we talk about it a lot, is that you don't have the quality trainers anymore. You know, I mean, nowadays you get a lot of rah-rah men. How many times you watching it on TV and you're hearing a guy go back to his corner and what the instruction he's getting is, hit him. You know, avoid the punches. You're no kidding. I got to avoid the punches. And give me something else, brother. You know, I mean, they're not being taught.
Well, there again, boxing is a matter of opinion. Teaching the game is a matter of opinion. But in teaching the game, the matter of opinion, there's still the game will never change. You got to have if you're right-handed, your left foot's got to be in front of your right. You got to have your left foot. Your left foot is pointed out. Your left hand is up higher than your right hand, which your right hand is closer to your jaw to protect your ribs and your chin. You know what I mean? But the position of a lot of guys now, you know, they're doing their own thing. You know what I'm saying? They're trying to find their comfortability, which is okay. I understand that because I went through the same thing. But trust me, I kid you not, if you keep your hands up, And you, because the same punches you throwing are the exact punches you got to block. And if your hand is out of position, how can you block them punches? Because you only got a fraction of a second. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Only there a short length of time. So if you keep your hands in position and you're moving your head properly, movement deflects punches. I don't know if I'm making sense.
No, you make a lot of sense, and I'm gonna make you laugh here. Now, I was talking to a young heavyweight recently, and I was watching him spar, and you know this guy's a big, you know, big kid. You know, he's like 6'3". He's pretty heavy. He's weighing like 270 pounds. You know, he's a little overweight and stuff. And he's sparring around, and all of a sudden he gets back, and his hands come down. He drops his hands, and he's sitting there, you know, pulling a Floyd Mayweather. And I go, stop. I go, what are you doing? He says, well, my hands are down because I'm out of the danger zone. I said, what are you talking about? He says, well, Mayweather, when he's not in the danger zone, he puts his hands down. So when I get in the danger zone, I got to put my hands up. I go, time out. I go, what happens after the fifth or sixth round when you're starting to get tired and now you think you're out of the danger zone and you're still within arm's reach? The next thing you're going to be doing is looking at the lights from the floor. You know what I mean?
That's right. Because, see, boxing, you're only a step away from boxing. You should be anyway. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So every time you jab, if you step, that puts you on the target. Where you throwing a 1-2, a 1-2-3, or 5-6, or 7-8-9-12. You know what I mean? That step, when you take that step, that puts you in the action. You know what I mean? And if you don't continue to step with that the most famous punch in the game is the left jab. If you don't continue to step with that punch, you take yourself out of the equation. You're not even in the fight, man.
Hey, man, I mean, you make a great point.
I don't know if that makes sense, but this is what they taught me when I was coming along.
No,
It
makes a lot of sense. You know, and the problem today is a lot of these kids think they know it all. They watch a couple of, they have all of this footage on tape that you guys didn't have the luxury of having. They watch a couple of tapes, and next thing you know, they're experts. But you fought so many great fighters in during your career, Ron. What sticks out the most? I mean, was there a guy that was your toughest? I mean, is there any particular fight you would love another shot at or you would have done differently? I mean, tell us about your career.
My opinion about the game in my era is that we had a spokesman in the game, Ali, which built the game. And everybody that was there in that top 10 rallied around that situation. Now, I'm not saying that we weren't trying to knock Ali out or we weren't trying to beat Ali. You know what I mean?
Right.
Because we were. Because I know I was. You know what I'm saying? But what I'm saying is he was a very special person. And that special person took the game to another level. And these kids now are coming into the game. If they would study the history of the game and learn as much about the game as possible, they appreciate what they're in. This is a chance of, this is an opportunity of a lifetime. And if you don't take advantage of that opportunity, it'll get away from you. And once it gets away, trust me, it don't come back. So while you're there, I think the kids should take advantage of what he has in front of him. Keep his hands up, move his head, move counterclockwise, clockwise, and learn the techniques of the game. Learn the arts of the game. You learn the arts and the techniques of the game, trust me, you can't go wrong. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah. Hey, you know, Ron, I talk to a lot of guys from your era, and you guys all say the same thing about Muhammad Ali and everything, and it's great. But the one thing that, you know, sticks in my mind, because I watched you guys, and I was a big fan back then, and a lot of the young people don't understand this, and I know you will, but, you know, as a boxer, you put it in great perspective how, you know, you wanted to knock his head off, but you knew, you saw while it was going on what this guy was doing for the sport of boxing. But what also was happening then, sometimes the fans loved him, and sometimes the fans hated him, and it could be the same guy. One fight he loves him, and the next fight he's rooting against him. What was it about Muhammad Ali that did that? And then now we look at this guy and everybody only remembers the good things. He's become an ambassador not only to boxing but to humanity.
Well, his uniqueness, his time that he came along. See, Ali come along. When Ali come along, we were in the heart of the revolution, the black-white revolution in America. And it was hard for America to accept confidence from a black man. I don't know if I'm making sense. But,
yeah, you do. We just were talking about the 100 centennial anniversary of Jack Johnson. Talk about a racial problem. I mean, that poor guy, I mean, right. they were killing right. people just right. for cheering for the guy.
Right, right. So here, we're in a time when the change came about, and Ali carried the torch. You know, he was a good representative. He voiced his opinion, which at this time, black athletes weren't voicing their opinion. You had a couple of Jim Brown, Bill Russell, people like that. People that were, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah. Yep.
So Ali came along at a very special time, and he took advantage of that, and he used it to his advantage, and two black people who could understand the struggle got right into him, and the rest is history, man.
Right.
You can look at Obama today and see that from that came a lot of things, and a lot of positive things, a lot of good things. And so black athletes, superstar black athletes, play a big part, a big role in black America. Back then, now, and forevermore. That'll always be.
Hey, Ron, you know, you were one of my favorite fighters to watch. I'll never forget watching you get in the ring the first time on TV, and I said to myself, oh my gosh, this guy is in the best shape. I had never seen someone as cut as you were when you stepped in the ring. And another guy that was one of my favorites that virtually no one remembers, and he's not with us anymore, but Jimmy Young. Jimmy Young was, I remember watching him fight Ali, and I swore that he beat Ali for 15 rounds, and they gave the decision to Muhammad. What was it like fighting Jimmy Young?
Well, there again, you win some, you lose some, they take some. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
That's the nature of the beast, right? Okay, so check this. I thought I beat Jimmy Young. I fought him twice. Once I fought him in I fought him in Frisco, and then I fought him
Honolulu, right?
Yeah, Honolulu, and I beat him. I thought I beat him worse in Honolulu than I did in Frisco, but he still won. But there again, that's the nature of the game. See, that's what I'm saying. You win some, you lose some, they take some. But that's what makes the both sides of the fence. That's where the game becomes the boxing game.
I don't know, man. Going to Hawaii, Honolulu, I don't know how you can concentrate on anything, especially a fight. I mean, there's so many other things to be looking at, you know what I mean?
I know. But see, but look here. But back in the day, fighters were in better shape. They were focused. They had their mind on, their minds was on one accord. Their mind was on one obstacle thing, and that was the boxing match. Now, boxing is an entertainment. They're thinking about everything but the event. Hey. They think about how many people are going to be in the seats. They think about how much money they're going to make.
They think about
how kind of movies they're going to get, contract movies. You know, get out of here, man.
Come on, man. They're thinking about what kind of tassels they want to put on their shoes, right?
Right, the tackles. And, you know what I'm saying? But there again, don't get me wrong. Ali took us to that level. So there again, the kids now are only emulating what they saw and what they were taught as Ali was coming along. That's why I say, is it a good thing or is it a bad thing?
Well, my personal opinion,
I think it's a good thing. I think because the fighters today are more creative than the fighters were in my time. Like, we were more creative than the fighters in Joe Louis' time, right?
Right. No, that's a good point.
So I would say that the game is taking it's going to take its toll. It's going to go up, it's going to go down. We're going to have a lot of this, a lot of that. But the bottom line is boxing is still the sport in America.
You know what's funny, Ron?
That's where you prove your worth, bro.
When you step,
every race, creed, and color that's ever came to this country has shed their blood in that ring, and we all prove our worth there. So boxing, to me, is still at the top of the heap.
I agree 100%. You know what's funny is that they try to emulate Ali, but Ali backed up his shenanigans. You know, a lot of these guys don't. You know, that's the big difference. But in 1980, it looked like your career was over. Your last fight was against Jerry Cooney. Then 15 years later, you get back in the ring in 1995. You rattle off 4 wins, all by knockout. What made you get back in the ring at 54 years old? Hey, are you not talking into your phone? All of a sudden, I can't hear.
Yeah.
You. Oh,
okay.
All right.
Okay. I was in Vegas at the time, and I was working at the Tropicana, and I was in security. The people there took a liking to me and put me in position over there to work in the casinos and be able to do some of the things I wanted to do. And there came along, opportunity presented itself for me to make a comeback to see what I could do. Every fighter, I don't care who he is, every fighter wants to see can he get back to that peak at that moment. And I'm no different. I wanted to fight it. I wanted to see if I can get back at George Foreman. And I wanted to get another fight with George Foreman because I never liked the way that one ended. I thought that I come up on the short end of the stick. But that's history, that's the way it goes, that's the game. But that was the sole reason why I came back, is that I wanted another fight with Big George. And George at this time was the guy. He was the guy in the game. He was coming back, and he was doing some good things in boxing, and he was drawing a lot of attention. And I figured that I could get a fight with him for a couple $1 million and live happily ever after.
There you go. Ride that horse, right? You saw that. All of a sudden, you saw that white horse in that sunset, right? You know.
You know what I'm saying? But it wasn't for me. It didn't happen. And so what I had to do was count my blessings and move on. But there again, God has a way of blessing us all. We just have to understand His blessing and embrace it when it comes. And that's what I did.
Speaking about moving on, tell us what you're doing now. I know you're working in the gym. You got some kids you're working with. Any pros? Any prospects? What are you up to, Ron?
Well, you know, it takes you a while to build an amateur program from scratch, as you well know. You know, you've been around boxing a long time, so it took me a good 5 years to get it off the ground. It's been in effect now, going on 9 years. Going into my 9th year. So I feel real good about things. I feel real good about my kids. My kids are starting to bite into the system of working hard, dedicate yourself, live clean, and do the right thing. And so now that they're starting to bite into this, the program is starting to grow. I got 2 pros, possibly 3, but for sure, I got two. And Jacob is my guy, Dominguez. I started with him. I've been with him now going on 4 years, 5 years. And I had to teach him everything from scratch, but give him a chance to grasp what I'm saying. Because I wanted him to be a pro, because I saw his integrity. I saw the boy's got balls, you know what I mean?
Yep, yep.
And so when I saw that, I said, all I got to do is be able to give him my concept of what I'm trying to get him to do, and let him go from there. And it's starting to pay off. Let's hope that he can continue to represent himself. And the kids in the gym are all a spit image of Jacob, the kids that I train. You know what I mean? They're all busy. They all throw a lot of punches. They all start with Jacob's left hand. He starts with his left. He starts with his right. He finishes with his right. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And he's all about combinations, whether it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, or 9. And from the nines, you can make 10, you can make steps and go 18, 19, you can go 42, you can go, you know what I mean?
Yep.
It's amazing what you can do with those combinations. And this is what I'm trying to teach him, is that boxing is about punches. It's about combination. And it's about series of combinations. And once you learn those series, pretty much you can dictate the terms.
Ron, I appreciate you spending some time with us, brother, and keep us posted on your program. I'd love to get even some of your young fighters on, you know, when they turn pro. I'd like to come out there. I know you're in Colorado, and we'll come out and we could do a showcase on them and all that stuff. So we would like to get involved. So you got my numbers. You keep in touch, all right?
Definitely. Hey, and let me say something. It was a man in the game that impressed me very much. And this man told me, because when I first went to Vegas, I was searching for what I was looking for. But he knew what I was looking for. This man that I'm going to tell you about, his name is Gus D'Amato. And I met him in Las Vegas. Gene Kilroy introduced me to him. And he's the guy that told me that I was a student of the game and that I was a good fighter. And that he asked me what I was going to do. I told him I wanted to learn to train. He said, you're going to make a good trainer. And he's the man that gave me some good information. And it's just like he told me, the way you train a kid, it's just the way he told me. I did like he said, and man, look at here. I've been having success like you would not believe, bro. You know what I mean?
I'm
this
glad.
This man was a very special person, and I'm honored that God put him in my path to meet and to exchange ideas with and to talk to. This man was way before his time, buddy.
Man,
way before his time.
That's great, because that's what we need, Ronnie. We need good teachers, and that's something that's coming. It's slipping. You know, there's a lot of these guys that are, you know, there's some kind of trainer, whether it be conditioning trainers or nutritionists or something, and next thing you know, they're in the boxing business, but they're not boxing trainers. They're not teachers. You know, they're reading a book. They're watching a video, and you know, the next thing you know, they have a stable of fighters, and I think that sometimes that's what the sport's suffering from. We don't have a good amount of teachers anymore, and it sounds like you're doing it the right way, brother.
Hey, like I said, I had people that sat down and talked to me. God put them in my path for whatever reason, you know?
Yeah.
But however the reason, it all's turning out in my behalf, in my best interest. Trust me what I tell you. And I met a lot of them. I'm talking from Angelo Dundee to Eddie Flush, from Eddie Flush to, what's his name, Yancey Durham, Jimmy Glenn in New York, Bobby Lewis. I had an opportunity to talk to people who were pioneers, who grew up with the Jesse Blackburns, the Joe Lewis's. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that knowledge that was placed in my path, I swallowed it up, man.
Well,
and trust me, what I'm telling you, there ain't no substitute for those people.
No, there's not.
Those people left a legacy in the game, and I'm one of the guys that they gave me information to, and I'll be giving it back to the game.
Well, you got the torch. Yeah, you got the torch, man. You got the torch. You know, we all start out as the younger one in the group, and then all of a sudden, someday, we're the older one, and we got the torch, and that's what it sounds like you got now. And, hey, you got my numbers. I got yours, and trust me, I'm going to be bugging you because we love having you guys on, and my listeners love hearing from fighters that fought in other eras, and we're always talking about Ron Lyle and Ernie Shavers and the whole bunches. I mean, there was just so many good quality fighters then, and you know, it makes so much sense that you're finally getting the recognition. At least on paper, people are recognizing the fact that you know, what a great era it was. And you know, I wish they realized it back then. But remember something: even during your era, Ron, they used to say when I was a kid, they used to say, these guys are good, but they're not like they were in the 50s. And now we're like, exactly. Right? You know, exactly. and now we're saying, oh my God, those were the best ever, you know. So,
but see, that's what I'm saying. The game never changes. It always elevates. Each generation gives something to the game. Each generation brings something to the table. You know what I mean?
Yep.
It's just up to that generation to figure out what it is. It's like we figured it out. You know what I mean?
They not only got to figure out what it is, they got to figure out what to do with it.
They got to. That's the times we living in. You know what I mean? Everybody want everything yesterday, not today, right?
Yeah, they wanted it 2 days ago, man. But
right.
Listen, bro.
You gotta work for it.
I'm gonna be calling you. We want you to come back, all right?
Hey, I'm as close to you as the phone.
That sounds good to me. I'll be bugging you. You'll be like, oh no, it's that Billy C again, man. So don't worry. We'll be calling you, brother.
I'm on it.
All right, man. Hey, thanks for spending some time with us. We look forward to the next one.
You bet.
All right, Ronnie. Good luck with the kids, man.
Bye-bye.
That's Ron Lyle. And we told you that he was going to be on the show. And he was one of my favorites. I mean, I kid you not. I remember looking at him going, oh my God, man. Muscles on top of muscles, this guy. But anyway, listen, we got to take a break. I'll be right back.